Good morning. Thank you for joining us today to kick off the Envisioning Virginia Tech Beyond Boundaries initiative. We're pleased to have Dr. Mary Sue Coleman here to open the conversation. Following her remarks, Dr. Coleman and I will engage in a 15-minute discussion, and then we'll take questions from the audience. Before I introduce Dr. Coleman, I'd like to take a moment to set the stage for Beyond Boundaries. I expect everyone here has participated in a strategic planning exercise for an organization, a company, or an institution such as Virginia Tech. These exercises typically engage the next 7 to 10 years. Our budgeting horizon is typically 1 to 6 years. These timescales are short compared to the time required for major and lasting cultural shifts. They're comparable to the time between recessions, which means that the planning environment is often different than the implementation environment. You may have experienced this personally if you bought a home a year or so before the real estate bubble in 2008. This is something that we've just gotten used to in the cycle, but it doesn't allow for strategic planning in the long view. Longer-term trends, such as the public disinvestment in higher education, the opening of income gaps, the progress toward the paperless workplace, and the migration of talent from suburbia to urban environments can be completely missed or ignored. With Beyond Boundaries, we seek to take a step back for a longer vision, one that might be characterized by a generation. And we ask two questions in the context of Virginia Tech. Number one, what will it mean to be a global land-grant university a generation from today? And number two, how will the landscape for higher education have changed? The second question involves that over which we have little control. It's an exercise in enterprise risk management. We will imagine scenarios, some likely and some not as likely, for which we must be prepared and to which we may be forced to adapt. This is an opportunity for Virginia Tech to look around the corner and adjust our trajectory or imagine new possibilities. There will be sea changes that we don't anticipate, but some that we can and should factor into our long-range planning. The first question engages what we can control, our vision for a global land-grant university that we can become. It should be an aspirational vision, and it should be tailored to Virginia Tech's unique opportunities and strengths. I'd like to add a third element, and that is dynamicism. Our new provost, Thanasis Rakakis, has started a discussion on campus that I believe will allow the university to adapt to the changes and opportunities that we cannot anticipate now. The combination of dynamicism and a vision for what the future might hold will allow us to realize our wildest dreams for what Virginia Tech can become. The Beyond Boundaries conversation is just beginning. Everyone's welcome to participate. And the scaffolding we have built so far for Beyond Boundaries is designed for engagement, input, analysis, and aggregation. I'd like to thank Kate Preston Keeney and her colleagues and the graduate students in Minnis Reidenauer's research group for organizing and facilitating this initiative. I'd also like to recognize our three co-chairs, and I'd ask you to please stand, Dean Alan Grant, Associate Dean Rosemary Bleesner, and Provost Thanasis Rakakis for their work in shaping and leading this initiative. Thank you. I can think of no one better to open this conversation than our speaker this morning. Dr. Mary Sue Coleman's academic career began in the lab, like many of us, after receiving her bachelor's degree in chemistry from Grinnell College and her PhD from the University of North Carolina. She built a distinguished research career at the University of Kentucky, studying the immune system. Her subsequent administrative experience and appointments included provost and vice president for academic affairs at the University of New Mexico, president of the University of Iowa, and a 12-year term as president of the University of Michigan. During her tenure at Michigan, Time magazine named her one of the 10 best college presidents in America. Last year, the American Council on Education presented her with a Lifetime Achievement Award. Shortly before she retired last year, Dr. Coleman told the editor of the Michigan Chronicle, quote, "I never planned to be a university president, but opportunities presented themselves and doors were open." Perhaps she didn't have a specific plan, but she did have a vision for education and the foresight to anticipate the challenges and opportunities ahead. This served the University of Michigan particularly well. During her tenure, the university completed a $3.2 billion fundraising campaign and passed the $1 billion mark for research expenditures just before the financial crisis of 2008. Her vision for education continues in her retirement. Today, Dr. Coleman is President Emerita of the University of Michigan. She serves on the boards of the Kavli Foundation, which promotes science and support for scientists, the Gates Cambridge Scholars Fellowship Program, the Mayo Clinic, and the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Foundation. She also serves on the board of the Society for Science and the Public, and she co-chairs the American Academy of Arts and Sciences Lincoln Project, which seeks to preserve the strength and diversity of public research universities. As we seek to invent the future of Virginia Tech, there is much we can learn from her experience, her vision, and her ability to prepare for those open doors that exist beyond our current sight line. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Mary Sue Coleman.
Thanks. Well, good morning. What a gorgeous hall this is. I'm envious. I want to thank President Sands for the invitation to be here today to learn about your plans for the future and to share some of my experiences from 40 plus years in higher education. Dr. Sands is doing what university presidents must do to succeed in leading their institutions. He is thinking ahead, way ahead. Leading a university really does mean focusing on the next 25 years and how the decisions that you make today shape your campus for tomorrow. It's challenging and it's invigorating, and it's really critical. By envisioning the Virginia Tech of 2047, you'll have to push yourselves with hard questions, with honest, sometimes difficult answers. And the rewards, the payoff for your hard work, will not necessarily be immediate. When Henry Tappan, the first president of the University of Michigan, delivered his inaugural address in 1852, he challenged the institution. "This young university," he said, "shall we not carry it forward to perfection?" His words continue to motivate us today in Ann Arbor, and that's why we're all here today. We want to move Virginia Tech forward in ways that will inspire and resonate for decades. I want to spend a little bit of time this morning talking about Michigan, a place that I know very well, a university that is one of the great research universities in the country. I also want to talk about the Lincoln Project, which, as Dr. Sands said, is an initiative of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences that I co-chair with Robert Bergeneau. Bob is the Chancellor Emeritus of the University of California, Berkeley, another great public research university. And finally, I want to leave time for a conversation with President Sands and with you about Virginia Tech, public higher education, and our collective future. The idea of the University of Michigan can be traced here to Virginia, about 150 miles away on the outskirts of Charlottesville. It was there in the splendid rooms of Monticello that Thomas Jefferson sat and talked with a colleague, a man named Augustus Woodward. Historians agree that the two men were great friends, united in their passion about the necessity of public education for the new republic. They were inquisitive about science and the natural world. They believed that human knowledge could and should be cataloged and classified. Most significantly, they understood that democracy demanded an educated citizenry. As president, Mr. Jefferson appointed his friend Woodward to be the first Chief Justice of the Michigan Territory, then a largely untamed area. To appreciate Mr. Jefferson's influence, know that Judge Woodward purchased 500 acres outside Detroit and called his new estate Monticello. But the more lasting product of their friendship was the University of Michigan. And we in Ann Arbor are indebted to the conversations that took place in the hills of Virginia. Judge Woodward conceived the idea of a bold public university in his new home state, and the result was the University of Michigania, based in the village of Detroit. 2 years from now, we moved in the intervening time, the University of Michigan will celebrate its bicentennial. Michigan grew in fits and starts, and there were times in the early years when it looked as if the university might close for lack of funding. For more than 30 years, Michigan functioned without a president for fear that too much power would be placed in one person. But sadly for the faculty, presidents have been a staple at the University of Michigan for decades now. Today, Michigan is a top public research university in the country. It reached that status not only because of visionary presidents, but also faculty who demanded academic rigor and students who excelled both in and out of the classroom. Regardless of the decade or the funding, we have never wavered in our commitment to society. In Michigan, we are driven by the ethos of one of our early presidents, an uncommon education for the common man. It is a sentiment preached by Jefferson, who ardently believed in the power of education and education for all, from the richest to the poorest. Public universities like Michigan and Virginia Tech have a compact with society, and especially the citizens of our states, to work on their behalf and promote the greater good. It is an obligation that we are privileged to fulfill. Earlier this fall, when the Times Higher Education World University Rankings made their annual appearance, American universities dominated. Of the world's top 20 universities, 14 are in the United States. No other nation can rival the innovation, creativity, and intellectual fervor of America's universities. None. Our institutions are responsible for America's knowledge security and intellectual well-being that advances health and medicine, business, social science, the arts, public policy, and the national defense. But we are threatened by shrinking financial support from our federal and state governments, and threatened by waning public confidence in those skeptical of our value and our contributions. I'm eager to spend some time this morning on how we must preserve and strengthen our great public universities, and particularly our public research universities, like Virginia Tech, Michigan, Virginia, and many others. And when I say we, I'm not focusing solely on the higher education community. Our state and federal lawmakers, our leaders in business and industry, and our great philanthropic institutions all have a stake in the strength and productivity of public higher education. I spent my entire career at public universities, from North Carolina, Kentucky, New Mexico, to Iowa and Michigan, and it has been an enormous privilege. When I retired from Michigan a year ago, I concluded 19 years as a university president. And I continue to be deeply involved, as Dr. Sands said, in the well-being of American higher education, particularly with the Lincoln Project. We are the Lincoln Project because of President Lincoln's historic signing of the Morrill Act in 1862, which led to our extraordinary system of public universities, including the Virginia Agricultural and Mechanical College. Today, as you well know, Virginia Tech is the leading research university in this state. It's all the more impressive that Virginia Tech, Michigan, and so many other public research universities excel, because now we face unprecedented challenges. We've absorbed decades of declining state support. It always astonishes me to reflect that in 1970, our state supported 70% of the educational expense at the university, while today it supports 16% and far less of the total university budget. During this period, we have worked relentlessly to control cost generate new revenue, and restrain tuition increases. All of these forces have left public research universities increasingly compromised in our mission to move America forward. Great research universities have long sustained a dynamic and a democratic America. We are essential to innovation, economic vitality, and educational opportunity. I think that we represent America's single best mechanism for addressing income inequality. Without the ideas and advancements generated by research universities, individual prosperity and national progress languish. While in earlier times our country rallied around science, education, and advanced learning, today these simply are not national priorities. We confuse the prevalence of modern technology with national strength in science. But the core of technology, as well as other advances, is science. Nations on the rise see support of research universities as an investment in the future. Unfortunately, now, many Americans speak of it only as a cost, and at best, as a burden. Vigorous, concerted action to support basic research is paramount, in my view, in contemporary America. Putting a man on the moon was extraordinary, but it was relatively simple compared with tackling global climate change, Alzheimer's, or diabetes epidemics. Recognizing the complexity of the problems we face augurs the capacity to solve them as a nation and as global citizens. This is why the Lincoln Project is issuing a clarion call for a 21st century compact, one with the federal and state governments, with nonprofit organizations, business leaders, philanthropists, and families to revive and stabilize and ultimately strengthen public research universities. Here's what we'd like to accomplish. First, there simply must be an increased investment in America's top public research universities by state and federal governments. It is essential that states reinvest in their public colleges and universities. Absolutely essential. Not doing so is so short-sighted and threatens to cripple remarkable institutions of learning. The University of California system is admired worldwide, yet the problems that it has had because of underfunding are very distressing. The same is happening in Madison with the University of Wisconsin. These are just the most dramatic examples of starved higher education budgets nationwide, but it's happening everywhere. If the state of disinvestment of the past few decades were to continue, we face catastrophe in the not too distant future. State contribution to our public universities at the rate it's declining now would start disappearing in the year 2022, beginning with those in Colorado. That's less than a decade away. Federal support is even more critical when it comes to research universities. The United States can claim 35 of the world's top 50 research universities, but we face intense competition from other nations that see the economic advantage of strong research universities. We are the most dominant country in terms of R&D performance, but that dominance is fraying at the edges. The U.S. share of global research spending declined from 39% in 1999 to just under 30% in 2011, according to the National Science Foundation. Contrast that with the R&D spending by Asian countries. Led by China, spending has grown from 25 to 34%. China alone has seen its share of R&D spending quadruple since 1999. Dan Arvizu, chair of the National Science Board, sums it up quite neatly. Emerging economies understand the role science and innovation play in the global marketplace and in economic competitiveness. This emerging situation has a direct correlation to the second objective of the Lincoln Project. We must develop new partnerships between corporations and private industry that result in direct financial support for public research universities. American business, to remain globally competitive, does have a vested interest in the talent and research embodied in higher education. As employers of our graduates, business leaders must advocate for strong, consistent funding of higher education. We've had this conversation in Michigan now for several years, and it has led to a new way of thinking. The Business Leaders for Michigan is a private organization partnering with our state's three research universities to help reinvigorate the Michigan economy. When our state was going through the worst of the Great Recession, and Michigan was hit almost harder than any other state, these executives advocated for increasing our state investment in higher education from its embarrassing status of 38th in the nation to the top 10. At the beginning of the 2000s, Michigan as a state was in the top 10, but it dramatically fell during the recession. To help make college more affordable for hundreds of thousands of Michigan young people, and to make our state competitive in the global marketplace, Michigan's business leaders made it clear. We need a long-term commitment from the state to make higher education a higher priority in the budget. And they put forth plans to make that happen over a 10-year period. It's made a big difference with our state lawmakers, who are now beginning to reverse the trend of disinvestment. We have a very long way to go in Michigan, but this collective voice of business support is encouraging, and it's very powerful. A third goal of the Lincoln Project is multifaceted and addresses aspects of higher education in the 21st century that I feel particularly passionate about. As universities, we have to continue to seek out and build partnerships and collaborations while also being as efficient as possible in our operations as major organizations. Private support for universities is no longer a luxury, it's a necessity. I'm certain that President Sands has a calendar full of meetings and events designed to generate more financial support for Virginia Tech. It's just an essential part of being a public university president these days. Philanthropy has always been a cornerstone of private universities. If you're at Duke or Yale or Princeton, you see it every day. The culture of giving back to one's alma mater is ingrained in those students from their first days on campus. Now, public universities must also look more to alumni and friends for support. If it isn't already, development must be a part of a public university's infrastructure, from the fundraising credentials of presidents and deans to the culture of student life. Universities have an obligation to ask, and alumni should feel equally obligated to give back. At the same time we turn to alumni and philanthropists for their support, universities have an obligation to control cost. It's imperative, regardless of state funding scenarios. And it is challenging because research is inherently expensive. There's no way around it. Research is expensive because it demands experimentation and exploration. We are people intensive and we are high tech in our approach, but we still have to constantly assess our processes to ensure quality and value in expending those precious resources that we have. Given this reality, we have to make sure that we're fit to use a current business term. I think it's apt, though. In higher education, fitness matters. At Michigan, anytime we look to reduce spending, it comes with a pledge to protect the academic core of the institution. It may not always feel so for our families, but we cut $235 million in operational cost in the last 8 years of my presidency to help offset tuition increases. We eliminated or consolidated hundreds of jobs. We centralized the use of classrooms to ensure that every new building project was completely justified. We asked employees to pay more for their health care, and we rationalized our IT operations. Only one budget item was sacrosanct, and that is financial aid. Here we added dollars, a lot of dollars. The result is for many of our low-income and middle-income resident students, it actually costs less to go to Michigan today than it did in 2004, and their loan burdens are lower than in previous years. And I'm really proud of what that means for Michigan families. We've also learned that we can make better use of our resources, both fiscal and intellectual, by working with strong partners. At Michigan, we've developed powerful partnerships on campus, regionally and globally, to benefit our state and the larger world. In particular, we looked at our fellow research universities in the state to leverage our collective strengths. The University of Michigan, Michigan State University, and Wayne State University began collaborating very seriously in 2006 by forming what we call the University Research Corridor to draw upon the talents of our scientists and our faculty in all fields. If there's competition between Virginia and Virginia Tech, the Michigan-Michigan State rivalry runs a close second. So if you can imagine the Cavaliers and the Hokies becoming arm-in-arm partners, then you have an idea about the eyebrows that were raised initially when Michigan, Michigan State, and Wayne State teamed up. It didn't feel natural. Many were skeptical. The legislature thought we were trying to pull some scam. Yet, the leaders of all three universities felt it was essential for the good of our state. And it works. It's a powerful and effective model that I encourage you to explore if you haven't already. Today, Michigan's University Research Corridor ranks among the country's top research regions in terms of research expenditures, intellectual property disclosures, patent applications, and new business startups. And our faculty are working closer than ever before because when the faculty see the leaders collaborate, then it becomes okay to collaborate across the institution. So great public universities fulfill the promise of teaching, research, and service. Most important, we have never wavered in our commitment to society. Public universities hold open our doors to students from all backgrounds, all incomes, and all cultures. We provide our communities with talented alumni, innovative research, and answers to complex questions. And this is certainly not the first time that we've faced difficult economic times. We can all point to challenging eras in the past of dwindling resources. And yet we persevere because the mission that we all share is so profound. Clark Kerr, the former president of the University of California, who did so much to define public higher education in the latter half of the 20th century, rightly observed, as society goes, so goes the university, but also, as the university goes, so does society. The progress of knowledge remains central to the progress of civilization. It's quite simple. Our collective progress and prosperity hinge on higher education. It is the strongest argument for lifting up our research universities. The onus is on all of us, faculty, elected officials, university presidents, business leaders, philanthropists, and parents to collaborate on effective answers. And I welcome being part of this critical national conversation. I do trust that together we will see that America's public research universities are powerful, productive, and globally relevant in the 21st century. Thank you so much, and I look forward to our discussion.
Okay. Well, thank you, Dr. Coleman. That was a fantastic introduction to our Beyond Boundaries initiative, and I think You set things in perspective for us. You know, I think this audience is obviously invested in this topic, and we all know something about various aspects of it. But to hear your perspective, having served 19 years as a president, I won't say whether I can imagine how that must
and,
be.
And survived.
And survived.
Relatively unscathed.
In several different environments.
Right.
I guess I'd like to open a conversation with a two-part question. One is, since you have been a university president mm-hmm. since 1995, and that's not quite a generation, but it's a good part of one. Mm-hmm. What, and I think this is the easy part of the question, right. What in that period has changed the most in the landscape for higher ed? And the other part is, what perhaps surprisingly has changed the least?
Okay. Well, let me try for what's changed the most. When I first became president of the University of Iowa, I really didn't understand. I came to understand it later, is how robust the state support was. Iowa as a state has always been sort of very committed to public education. And when we used to submit our budget, it was just mind-boggling to me when I really understood what we were doing for the state, is the state would give us usually a 5 or 6% increase. But that was on top of increasing the salary budget for the faculty and the staff for whatever we had decided we wanted. Mm-hmm. So it was just automatic. And the thought today that we could get any money for faculty and staff salaries, which we get in Iowa during the recession, cut that out too. So they changed their funding model. So the fact that we were still, as early as 1995, relatively well supported. At that time, Michigan as a state was way up at the top on support for public higher education. They were really doing well. So I think it's the funding pressures have changed. I think the environment has changed. I think the sort of the desire, and maybe it has to do with trying to solve financial problems, that legislators want to control their universities much more now than they did back then. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of that's changed. And I think it's been sad. One of the saddest things is this sort of public skepticism about the value of, because that was in my earlier part of my career, that was never a question. People understood that. So that's probably the biggest. The least has changed, I think, is just the wonder that all of us who are associated with universities experience every fall when this new class comes in. Mm-hmm. And we are again reminded why we're all here. And there's nothing quite like it. I mean, that's just a fabulous high. And even though the students come in and they're more tech savvy and this and that and the other, they're plastic, and we're going to change them and help them grow up. And that's that part I see is not changing much.
I would agree. One of the other things, general trends, that, and you touched on this, it's not just the financial disinvestment mm-hmm. that we've seen, but there's been the conversation has shifted, and we used to think of our public universities in terms of public good, and I think mm-hmm. our legislators thought that way as well.
Sure.
But there's been clearly a shift to the thinking of the products of the university being in the realm of the private good, mm-hmm. even for the students. Mm-hmm. And I guess my question is whether that, in your view, is a philosophical shift, or is it one that's necessitated by the structure of state financing? And the second part to that, is there hope of restoring the notion mm-hmm. that the public research universities are fundamental to the continued development of a modern civilization?
Well, one of the tenets of the Lincoln Project is that we can change that conversation. I mean, I think that the American Academy wouldn't have been willing to sort of put its resources behind this multi-year project if we didn't fervently believe that we could change that mm-hmm. conversation. You know, part of it comes from you know, it's sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy justification when public officials, you know, have to balance their budgets on the back of higher education, which they do, and they do it because we have this thing called tuition that we can get revenue that K through 12 can't, and that's the argument. You know, you can generate revenue, the other parts of public education can't, so you have to take the deepest cuts, which they have. I mean, public research universities, not people need to understand, took the deepest cuts of any sector of higher education. I mean, we have the data now from all 50 states, and the Lincoln Project is coming out with a new publication. Samantha Carney, who's here from the Academy, who's been working with us on this, we took an average of 26% cut across the country. The next closest was comprehensive public education, which took a 20% cut. Community colleges took less. K through 12 took almost nothing. And I'm not saying that K through 12 should have taken a cut. I just want everybody to understand the impact of what has happened to these entities, these institutions that do so much for the nation besides educating undergraduate and graduate students. I mean, it's a very difficult problem that we're facing, I think, as a nation.
If you were to begin a new presidency today, what would you do differently? Either because of the wisdom you've developed, and this is kind of a personal question for me, or because the prospects of the future are different than they were in, say, 2002 when you became president of the University of Michigan?
Well, certainly I think that any president coming in today, you know, is facing an entirely different circumstance, and sort of figuring out what the flexibility in the budget model is would be, you know, sort of job number one. Mm-hmm. If there had not been at the institution I was going, a deep investment and development, and there were the prospect, and all institutions can't raise $3.2 billion. I mean, I understand that Michigan is a very large institution, and it was able to sort of tap those kind of resources. But I think the presidents have to get much earlier sort of attuned to the philanthropy prospects than I had to worry about going in. And you know, there are all these issues on campus that students have now. We're now moving much more to an in loco parentis model. I went through the era where, you know, it was very much in loco parentis when I started college, and then it sort of started changing through the 60s, and then the students didn't want the university to have anything to do with their lives. And now we are sort of back, the pendulum has swung back, and now we're supposed to solve all the problems of all the students in their lives. So the pressures are different. I mean, they're very different. These are still the most exciting jobs in the world, and it's worth it because it's so consequential, it's worth it. So I think there are a lot of ways that I'd have to, if I were going in as a president now, I'd have to listen and be prepared for particularly financial issues. I think those are, and for institutions that have big health systems, the change is going on in healthcare, which I applaud in this country. I am a big proponent of more insurance for everybody. That then becomes another dimension of a presidency.
How do you balance disciplinary grounding with a need for dynamicism in the departmental structure and shared governance of a major university? I'm sure you've spent a lot of time working on that.
Yeah, we did. I mean, one of the things I reasons I was attracted to go to Michigan in the first place is it is a university with uncommon breadth of scholarly disciplines, coupled with, you know, deep disciplinary expertise. But one of the things I really worked on for the whole 12 years was to try to get people to figure out how there could be new associations and new structures within the university to get people to collaborate across those boundaries and tackle the problems that one discipline couldn't solve. And so we had a number of things in place. One of the most interesting, I'll describe it to you. The department structures are important because the department sort of defines the sort of scope of the discipline. And obviously our students need deep disciplinary knowledge. We can't just, you know, turn out students that have a lot of little knowledge a mile wide. You know, they have to know something about their topic. It's really important. But to get people to work together, we started a project. It wasn't my idea. I wish it had been because I thought it was so brilliant. But it actually came from three faculty members in our College of Engineering, and it's called M-Cubed. And I don't know if any of you have heard about M-Cubed, but it's a very interesting program. So what M-Cubed does is it basically assumes that every single faculty member at the institution has a token, and the token is worth $20,000. But the token cannot be redeemed and spent unless the faculty member cubes, gets together with two other faculty members who also have a $20,000, each one has a $20,000 token, to work on a project, and they have to be from different departments, different disciplines, different, they can't come from the same department, and they have to be, the problem has to be one that they can all contribute to. So now, when they cube, they have $60,000. There's no peer review, there's no picking winners, there's no nothing. You cube, you do it on the web, you've got a project, you get a check for $60,000. And now what you get to do is you get to hire a graduate student or an undergraduate or somebody to work on this idea that you have to generate some data. This has been fabulously popular, and we've had hundreds and hundreds of these cubes. We put $15 million into it the first round, and I think we've, at last count, those faculty had secured $22 million in external funding for their projects, and it's growing. And this was a way, I kept thinking about how can you lower the barriers to get people to work across disciplines, not abandon their departments. The department structure is still important. But, you know, there's a tyranny of the discipline that if you don't sort of find ways to work against that, you're missing an enormous opportunity. So we did lots of sort of things like that to try to get people to think outside those structures. But, you know, the people from outside the university don't understand this concept of shared governance, but this is a really basic tenet of, I think, why we are successful as universities. We're in this together. And the good ideas can come from anywhere, and very often they come from the faculty and staff. Mm-hmm. And that's what shared governance is about.
Well, thank you. M-Cube sounds fantastic.
It was fabulous. I said I was so jealous of these guys who thought about it. But as soon as I heard about it, mm-hmm. I thought, yes, this is what we have to do.
That's great. Mm-hmm. The University of Michigan is clearly a leading U.S. Research university, mm-hmm. but it's also got a global presence, and mm-hmm. it's typically ranked in the top 10 or 20 mm-hmm. Globally. I think the last ranking that came out, the Times Higher Education had Michigan as number 17, but the rankings are, you know, kind of arbitrary, but clearly Michigan's at the very top. Yeah. And as Virginia Tech continues to position mm-hmm. itself on a global scale, what from your experiences are the key components of advancing a global research university?
Sure. We were really quite deliberate about how we approach this issue because when I came to Michigan back in the early 2000s, you know, Michigan was known, but it was not, particularly in emerging economies that are going to become dominant in Asia, you know, people didn't know that much about the University of Michigan. And so we really started a strategy to say how are we going to raise the profile, how were we going to look at the positioning of Michigan, because I think you have to be deliberate about it. It just won't happen without that. So the first thing that we really did is that we put together a group of very distinguished faculty members who do work globally, and we did an analysis of all the work that faculty individually were doing around the world. And of course found immense, as you have here at Virginia Tech, your faculty are everywhere. And particularly because you have this agricultural component, which mm-hmm. is extremely powerful. And so we did that sort of cataloging, and then we figured out where I should make trips around the world and where we were gonna make investments. And so we China, of course, everybody is, you know, some point mm-hmm. has to be some presence there. Africa, South Africa and Ghana. We turned out that we had a lot of faculty working in South Africa and Ghana. Brazil is having some troubles right now, but it was important for us to be there. And India. And India is another sort of difficult situation for higher education, but we wanted to get a sense about what we could do. We have a portal on our homepage that we do in Espanol, in Hindi, in the African countries, English is the language, and in Portuguese. And we made a deliberate decision that we were going to translate some of our most prominent research articles in those languages and then create sort of venues for them to be used daily. We do this daily. We'll have news releases in Mandarin that go daily to the selected media outlets in China. And it's sort of working there, really making sure that we were getting our name out there, working on our sort of central messages internally so that we were all speaking with one voice. We don't have a campus overseas. We haven't done that. We do have a research institute with Shanghai Jiao Tong University in two areas of engineering, electrical and mechanical engineering, and that's an identical curriculum in English as the University of Michigan. They've got more than 1,000 students there now. Our students can go there. About 200 of their students annually come to Michigan to complete the degrees. We don't offer a University of Michigan degree there. It's a joint institute mm-hmm. degree, but it's been very successful. We really do work on this and think about it and how. And we've seen, we were in Weibo, which is the Twitter of China. We were there early. We were social media. I mean, we were going to be there because it was really important. We have international experts in our communications operation, mm-hmm. so it really worked for us. So I would recommend that kind of planning. Maybe you're already doing that kind of planning, but that really helped us a lot over the decade.
Being deliberate and thinking from their perspective.
Sure, and making strategic mm-hmm. investments. And this didn't cost us a lot of money. I mean, getting your news releases translated into mm-hmm. Mandarin every day does not cost you a fortune. And yet it will pay off in terms of your visibility. The media is not the same in China as it is here, but you need to get your information about who you are and what you're doing to the right people at mm-hmm. the right time.
We hear often about the tsunami, and sometimes the tsunami is sort of hit us and we missed it,
yeah.
or it's about to hit us. And mm-hmm. I guess one question I have from your perspective, if you could step back and look at higher education from not only a time, but kind of distance, stepping back mm-hmm. and looking at the big picture, is a tsunami looming, or mm-hmm. is it crashed around us already, or is it a metaphor that's just too simple to describe the environment for public higher education?
Well, somebody reminded me the other day that in the New York Times about 3 years ago, Thomas Friedman, mm-hmm. Enchanted with the idea of MOOCs, had predicted that residential campuses would be gone within a decade or something like that. And I don't think that's going to come to pass. Mm-hmm. We see these things that sort of, I don't want to be complacent, and I don't want to say that, we can just keep doing everything that we're doing the same way as we have in the past, because obviously we can't. But I think the imminent demise of the U.S. university is wildly overstated. We've been around for a long time. The concept and the basic structure of universities have been around for 800 or 900 years. I know that when I was in Cambridge, I go to Cambridge for this Gates Cambridge Scholarship Program, and I was talking about, the bicentennial, so proud of the University of Michigan, and they said, well, 800 years. This is our 800th anniversary at Cambridge. And some things have changed at Cambridge, but it is essentially the same idea. And so our idea of what we are has been pretty, pretty strong and resilient over the years. And there are not any corporations, not many, maybe there are some that can say they're 200 years old, but not many. And so the core of what we are is pretty darn good, but we have to be willing to say, okay, how can we respond to the times? So I would say that I think the tsunami analogy is wildly simplistic and overstated. But we are in a changing mode. And one of the things that has been so gratifying about the Lincoln Project is we have gone around the country and talked to all kinds of research institutions, public research institutions. The creativity and the ways in which institutions are responding is really astounding and heartening. These are dynamic places, dynamic institutions. People are not sitting there saying, don't touch us, we can't change. We are changing. but we are changing in ways that preserve what is best about us, and that is our commitment to the society and commitment to making a better America, and I think that's what we do.
I was at I believe it was an APLU or an AAU meeting a few years ago, and Phil Hamlin, who's the president of Dartmouth, but was your provost.
My provost, yay.
He made a very profound statement at the time, because I hadn't heard it put this way, but since everybody says this, that it's not about knowledge transfer anymore, it's about skill building, and that's where the residential campus comes into play.
Absolutely, and you know, and there is a place for segmented. I mean, that's the other thing that is so fabulous about the U.S. We have all these segments of higher education for different kinds of populations, and that's great. The residential campus isn't for everybody, but the residential campus is a very important part of this overall structure, and it provides important resources for the nation.
What is the one most important sea change you would anticipate for public higher education in, say, a generation's time, looking out to 2040-ish?
You know, it's hard to predict the future because some of the things that, you know, perhaps we thought would take root and really haven't. I do think that there is an enormous promise of technology, but I don't think it's an online learning per se. I think it can be supplementary to what we do sometimes in the ways that software can be designed, and we're at the infancy of this. I mean, it'll get better over time. Mm-hmm. I think our ability to predict that this whole area of data analytics, learning analytics, and trying to predict what will be successful for students and what won't, and then do immediate interventions. I mean, we have been very impressed at an institution, Georgia State in Atlanta, that they've made incredible gains in student achievement by having a very sophisticated data analytics operation and immediate interventions for students. And I think those kinds of technologies will give us a lot more power to individualize the experience that students have. And we're just beginning to understand how that can happen.
Yeah, I think the Georgia State's a great example. Mm-hmm. There are several of those universities, including Georgia State, are in the University Innovation Alliance.
Exactly.
I don't think either of our institutions are part of that directly, but we follow what they're doing.
Sure.
And the idea there is to maintain access, actually to grow access while maintaining a research university by becoming more efficient with the way that we use the assist from technology.
Exactly.
But so we'll all follow what they're doing.
Exactly.
And innovate on our own as well.
Yeah.
One last question I have before I turn it over to the audience. One last topic. Let's talk a little bit about football.
Mm-hmm.
No, I'm just kidding. We're not going to go there. That's a whole other subject. But I do appreciate your being here and providing your insight. I think one thing I, in listening to your responses, I think there's a lot of resonance with the higher education community. Of course, you've had so much experience and you've done this at different institutions. It's reassuring to hear that you're seeing things this way and that I think there's some common reason for hope going forward.
We have to be hopeful.
Yeah, we're excited about the future, as you will learn in your day at Virginia Tech. But thank you. I'd like to turn it over to questions from the audience. I think we have at least a mic here, a couple of mics here. Mm-hmm. So if you wouldn't mind stepping up and introduce yourself, and I'll let you direct your question to Dr. Coleman. Otherwise, we're going to talk about football.
Hello, my name is Leanna House. I'm in the Department of Statistics. And I have two questions. One is, I really like the M3 program too. I thought that was quite fascinating. And you mentioned, though, in your talk that you did similar collaborations with the universities in the state. And I wondered how exactly you were promoting the faculty or whomever to do the collaborations across the universities in the state.
How we are doing what now?
I thought that you said that with the University of Michigan State, that you were collaborating.
Yeah.
My question is more specifically, how exactly did you collaborate as a unit?
How did we do it? Okay. So, you know, there had always been
sort of individual faculty that would have a colleague at Wayne State or at Michigan State who would get together and work on a project. So that none of that was new. But what we did was we said, okay, we have common cause here. And so we created a pretty spare infrastructure, but we each institution put money in, and we hired an executive director who located in an office in Lansing because we wanted to be close to the state government. And we started with doing annual reports about, we put some money into some joint efforts that faculty, but they had to be from the three institutions. We had to get together to work on these projects. But we also started doing sort of economic impact using a very rigorous method to show what these three institutions did for the state. So we've published those annually since 2006. And then the other thing that we did every year was to take a sector of the Michigan economy, like the auto sector, the IT sector, the health sector, the agriculture sector, whatever, and we did a deep analysis of how the universities, what impact they had on that sector, and how they interacted with business. And so we had have an annual conference at Mackinac Island every year where all the CEOs from the state come. It's quite extraordinary. And we got on the agenda for that meeting every single year where we would do the economic impact report and the sector report with all three presidents there talking about how they were interacting and then illustrating how there was a growing collaboration among the three because we were promoting it as presidents. We were putting some funding up forward, but we were also doing cataloging to let each other know what we were doing. The other thing that we did that we thought was extremely important is we benchmarked ourselves against institutions in Northern California, Southern California, the Carolinas. What we're trying to say is we can always, sort of wow people with how much we're doing, but how much are we, what are we doing in relation to what Berkeley's doing and Stanford, together? So it was the benchmarking part that I think gave it more credibility. And we also used a very well-respected research group, sort of known for their tough stance on how they do the data for economic impact, because you can do these sort of funny things with, data that make it look better than it is. So we wanted
to a statistician, don't forget.
We wanted people to say, okay, you're really serious about this, and it's been interesting to me because I think, as I said, when we first and we would go up to the legislature and testify together, the presidents. And the first reaction we got was from the other public institutions in the state saying, this is a plot, you want to take money away from us. You're trying to get a bigger share of the budget. And we said, no, that is not what we're trying to do. We're trying to work on behalf. We didn't try to get a bigger share of the budget. We haven't gotten a bigger share of the budget. It wasn't us versus them. It was to say, look, people in the state need to understand what it is that we are actually doing beyond educating students, and there's a lot that we're doing. So it had many facets still going on. We still have our executive director. It has transitioned through, my change in presidency, and Wayne State's gone through about three presidents since then, and it's persisted through all that time.
Thank you. I have another unrelated, very short question, I think. I'm a little nervous because it's not meant to be passive-aggressive.
That's okay.
Is there a maximum number of students that one should have on any one residential campus? So your university has about 43,000.
Yeah.
Right, and we're right now growing, right? We have a plan of getting larger, and I'm just wondering, do you feel like a campus can get too large?
Well, it really does depend on your local circumstance. Michigan is 43,000 on the Ann Arbor campus. I don't see it It doesn't have aspirations to grow to 60 or 70 or 80. I mean, there's some institutions that really want to be the biggest in the country. I didn't have that aspiration. I don't think the current president has that aspiration. I think you always have to strive for providing a fabulous experience regardless of your size. And it just, there are huge implications. I mean, there are facility implications, there are faculty implications. They're all, I mean, if you're going to get big, you better be aware of what it means to get big and what you have to do to get big. And if you want to provide the same quality. So I feel like that at 43,000, the students tell me this, that the experience they have is far more intimate than they would ever have imagined, because Michigan is this whole group of small communities. And you can do that, and you can create it. And Virginia Tech clearly needs to decide how big it wants to be.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Good morning. That question segues into my question. When I think beyond boundaries and the future of Virginia Tech, I think of Blacksburg. And by the way, my name's Nancy, and I'm in the College of Agriculture and Life Sciences. So my question is, how do we include Blacksburg, the town council, the mayor, and the citizens of Blacksburg, and synchronize our changes with the town, and not just for the students, but for the faculty and staff who live and work here? What has been your experience in the other places that you've lived? And what are your colleagues and connections saying about that?
Excuse me just a minute. I think I swallowed water the wrong way. So, you know, having good relationships between the university and your location and your town, your city, is important. But your interests will not always align. And one of the things that we try to do at Michigan is to create an opportunity for the town to understand exactly what the plans of the university were and why we were doing what we were doing. For the city to let the university know. I mean, to try to reduce the potential for adversarial relationships. I think one of the things that really helped us in Ann Arbor, and, you know, I always thought I had a pretty good relationship with the city, and you know, we worked hard at it. We had an office that you do too here, I'm sure, works with the city. But this, you know, sort of narrative developed that, well, all you're doing is taking land off the tax rolls. And so, you know, you're harming, it's all University of Michigan. Nothing else is here except the University of Michigan. Well, we actually then did a land study, and it turns out that the University of Michigan only has about 11% of the land in Washtenaw County. The public schools, if you actually look at the public schools and some of the other tax-exempt entities, they're far greater, you know, taking things off the tax rolls than the University of Michigan. But it was a conversation that I think we always need to have and to see how we can work together. But I think it's fantasy to think that we're always going to agree, because we won't. I mean, you know, there are people in Ann Arbor who would love for Ann Arbor to stay the way it was 40 years ago. That's not going to happen. So I think you just have to keep trying to have the dialogue. And making yourself open and permeable to the community. I mean, we do have, and people can come in and use our library resources from the town, and we do all sorts of things to try to make that relationship a good one. But you have to work at it.
Hi, my name is Zach Hoops. I'm a senior in finance.
Okay.
And I have a question that kind of plays a little bit to what you were just talking about, but you were speaking about the shift in the public and the legislature's opinion of public universities.
Yeah.
And I was wondering, how concretely do public universities reclaim that position and concretely show, no, we do exist for the common good?
Well, you know, hey, that's the $64,000 question. You know, of course, we all want to do that. And I I think a lot of people feel like, well, if we just explained ourselves better, then everybody would understand. No, that's not going to happen, because the pressures on the legislature and the funding sources are real. They have real pressures. Medicaid is growing. Prison expenditures are growing. Tax revenues have become volatile because of the things that we are unwilling to tax. We won't tax services. We don't tax internet sales. The growing areas of our economy, and these are almost the only growing areas, are untaxed. The things that are not growing are taxed, but nobody wants to raise the rates. So you have a problem here. So I think we have to change the conversation. I mean, it would be much easier for state legislators if they had a more stable tax base and they could predict what their revenues were going to be. Now they're up like this. And when you have that circumstance, then, you know, what you do for universities that do have other sources of revenue, I mean, of course they're going to go to cut universities. There's nothing else they can do. So I get it. I get the fact that it's not because they don't like us. It's not because even maybe they don't think that we're part of the public good. It's easy to use an excuse. Well, you know, this is good for you, but we don't, you know, you're not doing anything else for the society. That's not true. But I get why it happens. That's why we need to start examining all these basic assumptions and say we have to change this because it's too important for the nation. Sure.
Good morning.
Hi.
Hello, my name is Evan Fitz. I'm a political science major here at Virginia Tech and also one of the ushers for this event.
Oh,
so my major is in the College of Liberal Arts and Human Sciences. And a kind of trend or feeling we have in that college is that liberal arts kind of doesn't have a place in a globally competitive research university. So do you feel as if there is a role for liberal arts in the development of a better research university? And if so, how can we better contribute to a university's mission?
Sure. Well, I went to a liberal arts college, and I have a Bachelor of Arts, not a Bachelor of Science in chemistry. You know, clearly, I believe deeply that the liberal arts are essential to an educated citizenry. And we did a study once because I kept getting this thing, well, history majors, you know, they can't make any money. This is a worthless degree. And we actually did an analysis of the salaries getting out of college and then 5 and 10 years later of history majors from the University of Michigan. And they were higher than the salaries of, I think, engineering graduates. So this notion that you don't learn anything useful from a liberal arts education is just nuts. You learn how to think, and you learn how to apply your knowledge to new and unforeseen situations. You know, I once had a description of, I thought it was the best thing I'd ever heard about a college president talking about theater students and why they are so well prepared for the world. Because he said, imagine going out on the stage and your cue isn't right. You're in front of an audience and you don't have the right cue for your line. These young people learn how to cope. And they learn how to bring it back so that the audience will never know that anything happened. That is a very useful skill. And it is transferable in many areas of life. So the discipline of making your mind work and not just accumulate facts and regurgitate them is the best thing that we give you. And that's what the humanities and the liberal arts do. So.
Thank you so much.
The humanist out here.
Hi, my name is Greg Fitch, and I'm research faculty in the Center for Automated Vehicle Systems at the Virginia Tech Transportation Institute. My question is, you were asked, you know, if you could do it all again, what would you do? And you said that a new president should become greatly attuned to the philanthropic prospects.
To the what?
Philanthropic prospects, how to basically raise money.
Yeah.
So my question for you is, what can be done to convince or persuade non-alumni to donate to your university?
So this is it always fascinated me that in my experience at fundraising at Michigan, some of our biggest donors did not graduate from the university. They just got intrigued with, what presidents do, what President Sands does, is you go out and you paint a vision for somebody. And the development, the work of development is to figure out what your donors' passions and interests are, and then figure out what you're doing at the university that would address that passion, and get those two to marry. And there's work on both sides to make it happen. But I think that one of the things that in engaging in your community and in your state, you will run across people who didn't graduate from Virginia Tech, but they like what you're doing and they're interested in what you're doing, or you can interest them in what you're doing. And people buy into ideas, they buy into success, they buy into, that's why they give. And many donors have said to me that the best day of their lives is when they wrote a big check and they gave it for something that they believed in. So that's what we do with philanthropy. And it's a great and noble work to do. I mean, a lot of people would ask me, don't you hate to ask people for money? I said, absolutely not, because I know the purpose that it, for which it is given is so important. And it will make you feel really good when you give.
Hello, my name is Jan-Hedrik Bern. I'm from Mechanical Engineering.
Yeah.
We're a land-grant university. There are a bunch of us land-grant universities around, and we typically talk about teaching and research and extension. Today, the new phrases are we learn, we explore, and we engage. A lot of the talks so far has been about learning and exploration.
Yeah.
What about this thing about engagement? What's your vision for the land-grant universities 30 years from now when it comes
for
to
engagement?
Yes.
Well, you are in the enviable position, because you are a land-grant university, so that you have this extensive system of extension offices where you have had this unique relationship with those communities. That relationship may change as technology changes, and time, but you already know the communities that you're in, and you have this network, which is a fabulous resource to have. And so what the future will portend about the ways in which you can use those extension offices, it may change, and I've not been at a university that had access to those, so I haven't really seen them in action. But it just seems to me, from a theoretical point of view, that you've already got this sort of these relationships that you've developed over decades that can and should be very useful to you in the future as you use them. I think that's the way I see it. Does that help at all?
It's a starting point. Thank you.
Okay.
Hello. My name is Akshay. I teach in the Industrial Design Program, which is part of School of Architecture and Design.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
My question is about the idea of a global land-grant university.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we are a land-grant university, and I've been here for long enough that I sort of understand the meaning of that. But the thought of a global mm-hmm. land-grant university dealing with, I'm assuming, issues of global nature, it's just too overwhelming. I'm just curious to know your vision of a perfect or an ideal global land-grant university.
Mm-hmm. So all of us want to be known internationally because these connections, the issues that we face usually are not nation-specific now. They're global issues. I mean, maybe climate change is the biggest one. There are going to be winners and losers. there are going to be profound challenges that I think land-grant universities will have a huge and even more important role in the future in addressing these issues. Whether it is, you know, what happens to regions that suddenly become arid and had water before, what about regions that have much more water than they can hold? I mean, you have the capacity and the expertise to really position yourselves to address some of these big issues, and there are going to be thousands of them. And so I think this kind of exercise that you're going through, where you can come up with ideas, are there various segments of the world that you think you have the most capacity to deal with? Are there areas of agriculture or engineering or whatever that you think you have a unique expertise and you could make a contribution? Are there partnerships that you should be making with other land-grant universities that will bring a bigger collective to the problem? But from my perspective, that global part of your mission has a very bright future.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Beth Osborne, and I am with the administration finance area in the College of Business. I wasn't going to ask this question, but I don't want to pass up the opportunity. So what I want to know from you is, obviously, we're generally trying to juggle value or trying to make a decision on value, right? And so one of the challenges we have in academics, and also one of the great things, is academic freedom. And everything is important because we're so passionate about the humanitarian work that we do, regardless of the discipline. But at some point, you have to decide what that landscape is going to be. And you have to decide that, because eventually when budget cuts come out and we find a sustainable way to continue as an institution, how have you decided value or ways that you've used to assess value? When the economy failed, we were all about assessment. We got to assess everything. Right. And so we went to numbers because it's something we hadn't traditionally done well in higher ed, not just at Tech, but everywhere. Mm-hmm. But we went to this big push of assessing everything, and so it was all numbers driven. And yeah. Someone who is generally deep embedded into the financial landscape of what's going on, particularly in the College of Business, it's difficult because there has to be decisions made. And at the end of the day, if we survive, it does come down to the dollar. Mm-hmm. But as we know, things cannot always be assessed by just, obviously, the dollar. So just yeah.
No, that's right. And I mean, that's one of the huge challenges that the financial leaders of the institution have, the provost, you know, the CFO, ultimately the president, in trying to make those bets about the future. Because, you know, clearly here, I know you probably do it, we certainly do it at Michigan, you know, we support some areas that can't generate enough money for themselves, but they're really important. I mean, I tell people they're always quite surprised about this, but I said, you know, the dental school is the most expensive entity in the institution because you could not charge enough tuition to cover the cost of preparing a dentist to practice. Think about this. Dentists go to school for their dental degree. They go out and they practice independently, unlike a physician who maybe has another 10 years of training. The expense of doing that is enormous, and clearly, you know, we subsidize it. Back in the 70s, when it became clear about the expense of dental education, most of the private universities in the country closed their dental schools. Dental education was left to the publics. If the publics had said, you know, we're not going to subsidize, we're not going to cross-subsidize, there would be no dentists. But like the good soldiers we are, we stood up and said, we're going to subsidize the dental school, and we do. I mean, you can make, each individual campus has to come to grips with what it's going to cut and what it's not. When we did our last round of, you know, trying everything that we possibly could to save money without harming the academic mission, we went to this shared services system. Now, some of you may have heard about shared services at the University of Michigan. So we started down this road, and our idea was that we would consolidate all this and, you know, take people out of departments all over the university and put them in one location we could run that more efficiently, more cheaper. We could create more actually staff expertise because people wouldn't be doing multiple jobs. They'd be doing the finances or whatever. It caused an uproar, and it, you know, we almost had a mutiny on our hands with the faculty. So, because we were taking, you know, Annie out of the department, and she'd been working there for 30 years, and they loved Annie. And not only did she do this little services thing, she also counseled graduate students on the side. And that was wonderful. That was terrific. So we said, okay, you know, we get it. We have to get more input. So we stopped the process, and we delayed for about 4 months, got a lot more input. But then we now have the shared services. Because you have to make choices about what you're going to do. We used to have big inventory stores, you know, with all kinds of supplies. We don't have any of that now because we do, you know, multiple deliveries a day. We do contracts. We do contracting with a multi-institutional contract. We do everything we can possibly do to cut our cost. But, you know, at the end of the day, we'll have to make Michigan, nobody has enough money to do everything. You'll have to make tough decisions about things that you're not going to be able to do anymore. But those, you hope, you know, will come with discussions of goodwill and, you know, trying to do the best that you possibly can for your students.
Well, I'd like to thank Dr. Coleman for a very stimulating start to our conversation
okay.
on campus.
Good.
Thank you for taking
Great.
This time.
Thank you.
Really appreciate
thank you.
Your,
thank you.
Your insight and wisdom. Certainly invite everyone here to be part of this conversation over the next academic year. I think it will be stimulating. We've got a great start, so thank you for being here.